Hi, how you doing, everybody? Thank you for being here. I picked a subject I think everybody was afraid of, and that was environmental and cultural influences in Loma Honda. And I kind of bent that to my will. Basically, what I would like to do is just talk about some of the techniques that I've used as an instructor, professor, and also as a printmaker to try to integrate what I've learned from the apprentice kind of model. So I'm not going to really read through these things necessarily. When I give lectures, I allow you guys to read it too, so I'm not going to follow it completely. But I just wanted to show you a few things that I've done as an introduction. So I've got some of my friends up here and a few examples of some of my assignments, one of which is what you have in your hand. But I've been doing this since 1996, off and on, more off than on, because I've become head of an art program, and that is a complete time suck. But so it's kept me from really doing a lot of work. But these are my most recent pieces here that you can see at the front also, and you're welcome to come up here after it. Please ask any questions you want. And then this last one was a design for Mokopongan's Patreon. That's a David Bull production. So I'm getting more, since I'm not head of an art program, I'm getting more and more into Mokopongan again, and I'm just really enjoying the heck out of it. I think that also my students have responded my enthusiasm about this, and I've integrated my Mokopongan practice into my normal printmaking introductory and printmaking two classes. This is the University of North Georgia, which is north of Atlanta, not the Republic of Georgia, which I've been asked. So I just want to kind of get around to my points kind of in an oblique way. I was an illustrator, commercial illustrator, before I became a professor. And I felt like a lot, excuse me, thank you, thanks for bringing that. I felt like I learned so much by watching other people work. We all, I feel like, have a tendency of getting into our own bubbles, per se, and just watching people that are better than you, to me, is golden. There's nothing better. And how do I take that to a student, per se? So anyway, these are some of my previous work for different corporations. So my most recent kind of experience of seeing better printers, better carvers than I am, was spending a month at Mokuhankan in Tokyo. And what I've tried to do there is to not only watch how to work, but also take blocks that were carved better than I can carve. And more as kind of as an assignment for myself to improve. And I should have had a detail, but some of the techniques that I was allowed to use these blocks really pushed me and made me understand that connection between good carving and good printing. I think oftentimes with students, they don't see a whole kind of synergistic aspects of things. So what I did for them is to carve, let me say something, carve a block, and they printed it with my supervision, blah, 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 which I'll get to in a second. But I know mostly, does anybody in here teach students? Okay, great, what? great, excellent. So you can relate, I think. So the target audience I'm referring to is 18 to 24. And oftentimes I feel like they want immediate gratification. They love to have something that they can have and hold and to be inspired with. So they love Japanese anime. They love the culture. They love the prints. But when you start teaching these things, oftentimes I feel like their enthusiasm wanes very quickly because, oh my God, how much work is this? Can I hear an amen? Amen. All right. So how do you feed? How do you feed that kind of like, feed them, you know? And so allowing them to print with these blocks that I've, simple blocks that I've made, really has been a great boon for them. It takes extra time, but I feel like it just kind of, starting almost kind of in and going back, is it allows them to see the potential and kind of get juiced and fired up about it. So anyway, this is one of my students with a print, a cat licking himself, which I thought was fun. And of course, you know, when you start these projects, it's very daunting. For them, for me, and so, what I did was I signed this, and of course it's kind of shameless self-promotion because this is my print company, Finicky Prints. So I made them kind of do advertisements for me. So it's kind of a combination. But the Senja Fuda, if you might be, you're probably familiar with that, are these small labels that were for shrines originally. If you have seen these temples, they're pasted all over the place, and I just love the graphics of it. It's just very exciting, the combination of typography and imagery oftentimes. So I tried to design these things so that the students would have just enough kind of challenge them enough, have a few technical points that they might find later on in common with their projects. So it gives it confidence, helps them understand the carving, and also how to get rich color too, you know, because oftentimes, even if we give demos, oftentimes the color is kind of weak, and I wanted them to have something that they can kind of use as a template later on. So what I asked them to do is kind of get into this production aspect of this, because as you know, these prints, these wonderful ukiyo-e prints, it was a commercial venture, right? And they were printing so many of them. And I feel like, to some degree, they're starting from the bottom. I mean, meaning, the beginners, the apprentices, they were printing way back when, they were printing candy wrappers, right? And if they printed those candy wrappers really well, they might go to matchbook covers. And they did matchbook covers. They keep going and going and going and refining and this idea of the students themselves hungering to create something, pushing themselves to a large degree. So when you'll notice this is a really crap print, right? Relatively. I mean, and so they do about 30 of these prints initially. Hopefully, when they get 5 of them that are really good, then I allow them to go on to their next project. I don't assign a grade to this, but it's more that kind of integration of the apprenticeship, this idea that you achieve something and allows you to go on the next step. Now, as a printer, I learn too, every time I do this, you know, just like drawing, you can't print enough, right? I can't print enough. When I'm there doing 100, 200 prints, my mind wanders. I make mistakes, all that kind of stuff. And students with their cell phones, I mean, you've got even worse than that problem, right? So anyway, I feel like that idea of focusing, that idea of quality control, of attention, really, really, it's done wonders for the students, in my opinion. And wonders for me, too. But like, you know, I evaluate them, and then they evaluate their own prints, too. They say, okay, what's the problem here, diagnosing these things? You can see the notation. So they have a lot of fun doing it. They give them to their family and they give them to y'all, and they were very pleased to be a part of this. So thank you for allowing me to, and if you haven't gotten your free press, please. And if you want a couple, that's fine. They make great, great bookmarks. So anyway, that's kind of what I do initially. Now later on, and this is rare that I have students that quite get to this point, I've got blocks that, just practice blocks, and this idea of color overlapping, you know, how do you get these wonderful colors, and how can you kind of strategize to make the blocks as efficient as possible, to think in advance on how to design a print that uses that those concepts of color overlapping and transparency. So that's, I've had only about 5 students get to this point. So admittedly, this is a work in progress, but I find this to be very useful for myself too. You know, trying new color combinations and that type of thing. A few technical stuff. I mean, it's hard to get material. I generally buy all the stuff for them because if they're really that interested, I go ahead and contribute. But and we use watercolor tubes and things like that just to keep things at a little minimum. The paper is probably the biggest problem for me. And this is the type that is just proofing paper, which I think is what I use for the center proof that you have. Anyway, I guess I don't want to kind of, what time is it? Okay, well, that's great. I was told that maybe I would have an interview, and I was worried about that, so I kind of wanted to make it short. Can I open it up to you guys a little bit in terms of...
Well, why do you freeze them? Fry freeze the paper.
Okay, great. So, to keep the mold down, so if I have a Tuesday, Thursday class, I really worry about they might take a full month on a print. And so putting in the freezer every morning, after class and then getting it out in the morning is the way that really we get around that. I think for students, it's such a laborious process and it takes so much time doing these events that you worry about that. But
so does it, is that, I mean, do you not let the paper dry?
Eventually, yeah. Yeah, eventually we flatten that. But so we use newsprint in the stack, really thick on the top and really thick on the bottom for both the to be printed and after being printed. And it bundles up, and we do kind of a chubon size, relatively small size. So there's enough room for the students to put it in a small freezer and stack them. I have to come in every morning at around 7 and pull those stacks out for a 9 o'clock class so that they're ready to go. I've had a few problems before in which I kind of put it into a heating, silkscreen heating bin to help the process. Yes. Andrew,
what's the time frame of your classes? You know, how long do you have the students for them to go through both the Center for Data Product and their own print projects? And
all right. So I only have one set of blocks with these the Center Fuda. Yeah. So that's one thing too. If I have some of them printing, some of them designing their imagery and that kind of stuff on the computer is how I do that. So it kind of helps to balance it. It's like a multitasking situation. So my classes are about 2.5 hours. Fortunately, the printmaking lab is open all the time, except for Sunday. So I have a lot of students that have to come in anytime and work on it. But one thing I found useful too is that I've got 2 printing stations in the print lab. One that I'm always, not always printing, but I'm frequently printing. And so they're next to me. So if you've ever, I just love working with somebody. I mean, admittedly, I guess I'm better than they are because I've been doing it a lot longer. But having that kind of stealing is what they say. stealing the technique. And you can, as you know, you can read, you can look at YouTube videos, which is helpful also, but having it there, getting the sound of it, to me is quite a key too. You know, it just sounds right. You know, it's one of those ineffable things you just have a really difficult time defining. So having somebody working next to you is just wonderful. How many times, how many of you guys have been able to watch other people print next to you? Everybody? Yeah, yeah, so you agree with me on that? Yeah, yeah, yeah. When I started using these techniques, they would just get so frustrated, and that's why I feel like using blocks really kind of keeps that energy up. Yeah, great.
Could you speak a little bit more about working or designing on a computer and how you translate that to a woodblock?
Yeah, sure, sure. So that what's kind of helped me is combining this old and new, you know, in terms of creating new classes and kind of integrating it digitally. So the students will design these things on the computer itself, and then we will take a print of that and paste it onto the block and do it traditionally from there. So yeah, using a Gombe laminate kind of thing. So it's a very thin paper laminated with spray melt onto a sheet of paper. Then it's run through the laser writer. Then that's pasted down using Yes Paste generally, and then laying that down with a Kento. So that's how we kind of start with that. And then later on, they use the printouts, the color printouts, the design, but they will do their, of course, their key block and use that with a consecutive colors later on using that same kind of technique over and over again. So, man, I'll tell you what, it wears me out doing this stuff because there's so much there. I the most students I've had at one time were 8, and I don't want to do that again. I'm so happy that it's not too popular because 15, I blow my brains out with all this kind of stuff. Yeah, yeah, please, thank you.
In that context, I was wondering if you could give us a little bit of background about the department, you know, where your course, the Mobile Mama course, fits into your department, and what the reception is from colleagues, and
yeah.
Maybe just general status or popularity of it.
Well,
as
you
probably speaking.
As you probably know, there's a lot of education that goes along with that. I tout the non-toxic aspect of things. Our dean is very into Asian studies. I've been working that like nobody's business. But in terms of just bang for the buck, as far as time and resources, they see how much time and effort and my own money goes into it. That kind of makes them say that they can't say no to this kind of stuff. So far, I've only had a student with through 3 semesters, which is a year and a half, using strictly Mobile Honda. So you get to a point where it's just independent study, and I do that for free, and I'm a sucker. But looking at the end result, and I'm sure you guys feel this way too, you see this, and I've had some students that are just, they can't not do this. There's something about this. Now, if I can just wean them out of the anime world a little bit, that would be great. But there is some kind of, I don't know, help me here. What is it about these things? What is it about this, the look of this? This is so beautiful. I mean, it integrates the paper aspect. I used to teach paper making, which was really wonderful. We could do paper and also the printing, but I haven't been able to do that lately in terms of numbers. But it's just such an integral part of the whole process. So I would just love to be in a position so that I could, you know, have a degree in this. Which, how many other institutions, if you don't mind me asking, I'm going to ask you a question, is that okay? How many institutions do you guys know of in the world, the United States, that integrate that into the college curriculum?
Surprisingly, Durham is the University of Hawaii and Hilo has great papermaking department. I was just, they're doing a class with their students, and they have had a strong papermaking program for the last 6 years. So that was a surprise to me, though.
Yeah.
But that's an Hilo and the Big Island.
But I talk papermaking here in the Archer.
Oh, great, great.
Through the fiber department.
What was your, how did it go with you?
We start off with, you know, we do Japanese, and then we do Western, then we move.
Oh, really?
And one of the things I realized is the students don't make paper, and it was a pretty full class of 12, 15.
Wow.
And they would get, what's the word? I mean, they think the paper is the art. Then you have to remind them that that's the media. Then they have to move on.
It becomes precious, right?
Yeah, and then we did a whole section in recycled paper. So, you know, they had to do a natural thing that they found, and we did recipes. I have books on different recipes of different plants. And so, you know, some worked, some didn't, but at least we knew if it worked or didn't, or they had to do combinations of adding avocado. But then I shifted from the art department to Hawaiian studies, and I teach kapa making, bark cloth. So we start off with bark cloth, then we take our leftover wall kits and we make paper. So we still make paper, then we take it into books and print making.
Isn't there a Walla Walla Washington has a program?
Yeah, she's here.
I'd love to talk to her.
She's speaking next.
Next.
Oh, great.
There's also, in Finland, we have got also papermaking. There's a papermaking studio, especially for Japanese papermaking also. All the tools are there. It's not in our art college or art university, but it is connected. And also in art academy, they have got the equipments, and there are courses, but lately it has been the Western papermaking. Because it's much easier to press and do the Japanese papermaking needs more space, needs the drying boards. There's lots of things to consider, but it used to be popular in the beginning of 90s. So I was teaching also papermaking, a lot of Japanese papermaking. But nowadays it has switched back to the Western because of the easiness and the kind of a space problem, but the equipments are there, so I'm looking forward to use them again someday, probably. So it is set up there, so Finland is advanced.
So any other questions you guys have? Yeah, please.
This is for all of you that teach in printmaking programs. The term mokohanga, how many of you use, is that term not strictly your own usage, but within the department or the advertising of the course, mokohanga is used? And John, I was wondering, at your university, do you,
you know,
is
I don't,
your course pushed as
it,
a mokohanga course?
Thank you.
Or?
I kind of done the Trojan horse thing, and in terms of, it's during my printmaking one that I introduced that along with Western techniques, so it's a combination of the two. It's not in the description of the class at all.
Even though it is
strictly
mokohanga. Okay, is there anyone else to comment on the use of that term?
Well, again, Finland is advanced.
Yes.
So in Aalto University, it's another big art university in Finland, besides the art academy. The mokohanga courses, there are two times spring season course and the autumn, and they are always fully booked up. And so many, so 30 people or something, queuing up, waiting to cancel. There is the feared 15 students. They have to take it full, and it's hard to teach 15, I know. 6 is the best,
six.
Maximum.
You're right.
But I think I go to...
I have to translate it into Italian. So it's called mokohanga. I call it Japanese printing.
Yes.
And then I specify further, you know, water-based and printing.
Yes, the water-based is
I just talk about like what I do, but I haven't introduced woodblock yet. I'm still new, but I use up the ring and LL.
home open print shop here, Foyin, your print shop has increasing interest in local Hongkong, correct? I mean, is that a fair statement?
Perhaps Yong can talk about the print shop, I can talk about the university maybe later on.
Yeah.
And I think because I would say, because we won't use the terms of local hunger, we'll use wood printing, no matter it's water-based or oil-based. So I think it's the most accessible media amongst all those printing techniques. So actually, we work with the Hong Kong Polytechnic University, and the time, you have 15 weeks. How many weeks?
We have five.
5 weeks. Well, so we did really basic technique and let the people, let the student try. So I think that's really, to me, it's quite interesting that we just taught them really simple technique in order they don't get cut. And then they and then for the rest of the 4 weeks, and they explore the media themselves. Of course, we just offer some basic technique like the carving technique, inking technique, and stuff. And as the lady is gone. As you said, that some work, some didn't.
Yeah,
but I think it's a good experimental opportunity for them to get an idea of what the printing is. And we start introducing. We are hoping in the future that the Japanese printing type, because we have artists practicing it now. Of the Chinese traditional technique.
Mm-hmm. Well, in my case, the woodblock thing is just part of the image subject. So out of the 14 or 13 weeks I have to squeeze this 4 or 5 sessions into it, in order that student can be open to this kind of technique or imaging.
Right.
So that's my basic kind of concern. So whether they want to do it in their latter years or not, it's up to them. And like you said, if they come out okay, it's good. Otherwise, it's just like they're just exposed to one of those imaging techniques and that's it.
I see.
It's not much expectation out of it.
Okay.
Just an exposure.
Thank you very much.
Yes, please. Thank you very much for helping.
Thank you, John.
My name is Ellery, and I am a printmaker from Imperia, a lovely Italian city near the Mediterranean Sea and the Alps. I'm a printmaker, and I'm here to share with you the passion for my for Japanese woodblock print that I embraced and to which I opened my heart in 1992, 25 years ago, thanks to my master, Licustro Giovanni Berio, that you see here, and he was my teacher for Mokuhanga and a real original Italian maestro. But then I had the great opportunity to meet Licustro, and I was at first accepted, and I introduced in his art atelier as a guest. I was just a teenager. And several years later, I became an official apprentice and worked with him. And after many years working together, since 2009, I became his one and only printer. All Licustro's print since 2009 have been printed by myself. And also, we could cut together all the wood blocks. It has been an immense honor for me, and a joy, of course. And today, it is my job. After more than 20 years of often work with Licustro, I started 3 years ago my own printmaking studio, also located in Imperia. And the love for Mokuhanga is growing day after day in Italy. And all of you are very welcome to visit me in Imperia and also the new gallery opening next November, which will host 1 week each month a permanent Ligusto solo show, focused time after time on drawing and a lot of other pieces of art from my master. My voyage with Ligusto didn't stop on December 2015, when at the age of 22, he passed away. Today, here, we are together talking about him, and the dream continues. I took on the challenge, myself and the Ligusto's daughter and sons, Annalisa, Francesco, and Giuseppe, to share and to show to as many people as possible how extraordinary Ligusto was as a maestro and how astonishingly beautiful his masterpieces are. We are sure you will follow in love with the colorful and luxury Ligusto spring style. But allow me to explain more. Let's take a step back. Who was my master? Imagine a man that born in Italy in 1924, when went throughout the Second World War in his young age, and then traveled all of his life as a chemical technician inside the olive oil industry, who at the age of 62, after a heavy heart attack and the coma that followed, embraced a complete life change. He discovered for first time in his life drawing. He discovered the art for first time in his life at the age of 62. Drawing at first, then painting, and dedicated himself to the study of art and artists. He became passionate about Impressionism, and over 30 years ago, he started talking about the passion for the Japanese culture, art, and lifestyle of the late 19th century in Europe. He understood the Japanese, which existed, and the great influence it had on important European cities and countries like Paris and London initially, Germany and Austria later. He was able to catch the Japanese effect on visual art and painters too. Ligusto was keen on studying, researching, and mastering all about the subject he was passionate about. To better understand the Japanese, he decided to learn more and to depend the Japanese art and the Japanese artist. He went to visit the Chiosone Oriental Art Museum in Genoa, incredibly the most important museum of Japanese art was only 1 hour away from Imperia and him. He was fascinated by the magnificence and technical perfection of Mokuhanga prints. Like a challenge to himself, because the staff of Kyosone Museum explained to him that it would be quite impossible for a Western artist to become a Mokuhanga printmaker, he decided to embrace Mokuhanga and carefully analyzed the prints displayed at the museum. As you can easily imagine, he became the first constant visitor of the museum. Each week, he went to see and to study the prints and became a friend and very well known by the whole staff of the museum. They showed him also some special prints from the collection, not otherwise exhibited to the public. Since 1986, he was dedicated himself exclusively to to the study and production of Japanese color woodblock printing and the Nishikie techniques in use during the Edo period. Ligusto started creating prints hand-pulled by Baron on washi paper as a self-taught artist. He never went to Japan, nor anymore passed him the practical method for Mokuanga. No one explained to him how to cut the wood blocks. He did not have any of the special and highly performant Japanese tools like knives or carver, but used to make his own artisanal tools, named ferri, or irons in English. No one explained to him how to make it a self-made baron, how to use it to print, how to make colors from pigment, but he was a specialist in chemistry and research, so he started making an impressive number of experiments to obtain the same effect he has seen at museum. Japanese television came several times to Imperia to interview Ligusto, who was featured in 1995 on the Japanese magazine Marco. And in the television program My Miracles Do Exist, aired on December 3rd, 1997, between 7 and 8 p.m. If interested, of course, is only in Japanese language, I can send you the original of the program. During our long stay at work at the atelier, Ligusto described to me all gestures, technical secrets, and specific methods used by Japanese engravers and printmakers. And I looked, learned, and figured all of it in my mind as well, wondering myself how he could know that much about Mokuanga printing technique and the engravers and printmaker lifestyle. I was so surprised last January while watching a movie for the first time in my life, produced by the Adachi Foundation of the Woodcut Printing during my visit in Milano, of the show Followed Away that you see here, focused on Utamaro, Hiroshige, and Hokusai, around 200 masterpieces, all from our next door Honolulu Museum of Art. I saw replicated on the screen gesture, techniques, and methods Ligusto was talking about, and then I finally understood the title of the article on the Japanese magazine Marco, as published in 1995. Hokusai, a reincarnation in Genoa. And 22 years later, I can say, yes, he was. Ligusto gave lectures and practical demonstrations to bring this highly stylized artistic technique and its fascinating history to the general European public. Between a lot of events, exhibition and solo show during last 30 years, I will focus on the one organized by the Embassy of Japan in Belgium in 23 in Brussels, Aomori or Liguria, between Japanese extreme East and Italian extreme West. Moreover, the big echo of a one-day-only Ligusto solo show in Rome last October, almost 1 year ago, had. This exhibit, organized by Francesco Virgo, had the patronage of the Embassy of Japan and Italy, the Italy-Japan Foundation, and a lot of other establishment to celebrate, and also the Ministry of Art and Culture. culture, and the foundation to celebrate the 1,005th anniversary of friendly relationship between Italy and Japan. This exhibit, organized by Francesco Verio, had the patronage of the Embassy of Japan in Italy. It took place at the Central Archive of the Italian State in Rome, in which the original of the treaty was displayed, signed by Italy and Japan, was showed for the first ever time in honor to Le Gustro's work. A lot of people came to visit this wonderful one-day show. 60 masterpieces were displayed, and a lot of Le Gustro's enthusiasts and supporters make this show unforgettable. The Council of Japanese Belt, 3 Ikebana schools, the tea ceremony, school and national association of Aikido, origami, calligraphy, sumi-e, and the manga were all together in the same place at the same time for Le Gustro and Japan. Le Gustro received great appreciation from art experts and critics. The full version are available at the website www.legustro.it. Today I want to point out only on two of them. Jack Hillier, author and expert for Sotheby's London, specialized in Eastern art. He had a great esteem for Le Gustro, and all the original letter between Le Gustro and Jack Hillier are now actually property of the municipality of Imperia City. Le Gustro made the print Jack Mary Hillier's doll, Mary Hillier's dolls, and donated it to Jack Hillier's wife. And also, Professor Fukuda Katsuhiko, born in Osaka in 1929, professor at University of Kanazawa. He was being one of most important experts on the Japanese art and also about Shunga prints of Japan, China, and India. And a lot of book he wrote during last 50 years. Le Gustro made around, he's an Italian critic, Le Gustro made around 300 different woodcut prints. Some have an extraordinary dimension of 2 meters square and the unbelievable number of 480 different colors. He was fascinated by the magnificence of the lux embellishment technique, especially used in Japan for Surimono and Shunga, and in each of his prints, he used a lot of this technique. This is Lindsay Cabe, he's a friend of Le Gustro, and he is an artist, a dancer. No photo could ever hope to match the timeless Baroque beauty of Le Gustro's work. They are an extraordinary example of these antique and fine embellishment techniques. In honor of the great maestro Le Gustro, I encourage every modern artist and printer to rediscover, use, and include in today's works the ancient luxury techniques of Japan woodblock printing, such as Bokashi, Jindei, Jinsunabu, Hirazuri, Karazuri, Kimekomi, Kindei, Kimpaku, Kinsunabu, Mokotsu, Sabibori, Hirae, Uruzei, Nunometsuri, Krepin, Suyatsuri, Fukimotan. And I have some original prints of Le Gustro from my collection. And I take some photo to show on a big screen how the light touch on the surface. as you can see here, there is a frog. The Kirazuri is the a technique named also gaufrage, and he made a three-dimensional effect on the paper. And you can see here the frogs that have all the three-dimensional effect. But from the front, you cannot see it. And also in another print, there was a, this is a bird from the sea, all along the wire, and you can see the three-dimensional effect that you need to make. This technique. Kirazuri did not utilize pigment. The effect is created by pressure alone, without color, in order to create the relief and two-dimensional tree. And it is made by carving a special wood block only for doing it. Kimekomi is exactly the reverse of Kirazuri. So here there is the relief is on the other sense. This is another print from the costume, and from the front you can see nothing, but if you change the inclination here, you can see the Mitsubishi. It is a method used for to have this brilliant with gluey varnish. And also here you can see the kinzei, the color given by powdered gold to cover small area and of the prints with decorative motifs. On there, of the line are in the golden powder. This is the print for Mary Hillier's. And here you can see the Urze. A part of the print is covered by lacquer. Here only the hair. And also the table. This one is the print where there are the print with the three-dimensional effect. And also Kimpaku is the same print. Just one more. Is the same print. From the front you cannot see nothing, but all this side is in gold relief. And it is a really big area. And this is the Kimpaku style. All this, and this. This is another print. Sorry for showing it horizontal, like my. But I'm not so good with program, and I wasn't able to turn it vertical. Sorry, but now it's bigger than vertical, so you can enjoy it better. And here you can see the Kinsunago. Is a technique made with gold flakes and powder scattered on the surface, and it create effect of light in the individual part, or later, in this way, all print may are is made identical because there is a block carved exactly to make this effect. And also, Kirazuri, it is this is all in the print with the bird, the sea bird on the lake. And this is all Mika print that make brilliance on the print, and the name is Kirazuri. And you can see here also the light of the leaf gold. Bokashi and Hita Bokashi, I think all people know it, but there are some different Bokashi and Hita Bokashi style, so it is possible to make the gradation vertical, horizontal, from a side, from the external line to the center, and from the center to the external. And also the Jindei is the use of the powered silver to highlight fine details in the print, like the gold, but with the silver. Jinsunago is silver flakes and powder scattered on the surface, like the gold but with silver. Okotsu is a types of painting or engraving involving painting figures without creating outlines. And the Gusto named it work without bones. And Sabibori is a method of engraving used to create the effect of brush strokes in Japanese calligraphy. He really loved to include the calligraphy in his prints, and also he had some a friend, a lady from Japan living in Imperia, and she was a really good calligrapher and make a gift for him. Here you can see the leaf of gold and a lot of technique, not really mentioned because I cannot to transport it. And also I participate with this. This is all with Mika and the silver and other pearl. Sons and daughter give me as a present after the Gusto passed away, and this is Kalura, and it's little, but I really, really love it, and it had really a lot of different deluxe techniques, and also the transparency that you can see in the body because of the ombra of umbrella. And also he really, really liked the butterflies. And this is two of three. Inside there was another print that is not possible to show here because FedEx lost it during the transport, and unfortunately I hope in 2 or 5 years I have it back, but I don't know. It must be exposed at the show, but you have the other two parts here to see if you want. This have the flakes of gold, but this is my first wood block with Rico Store. After several years, I worked with two different colors.
should we throw open some questions now?
Yeah,
if anybody wants to ask, anybody has some questions?
And is it okay if the next speaker sets up her? Are you finished with the computer? She can step in and just test her.
Yes.
Do that.
Yeah, sure. I don't know what time is it.
We've got about another 5 minutes.
Oh, what?
Yeah.
Okay. So I can stop this computer if you need to.
Are you finished with your?
I think yes.
Okay.
So Surazuri is a surface polishing or varnishing, and it make like a silk or lacquer. Mm-hmm. And there is another one, the creping is the system to miniaturize the print, and it was made by a press. And the last one, the Fukibotan, was a spray technique to make by Goffman the spray effect to represent the dust or snow and stain.
Did Bistro discover all these techniques by himself, or did he have any reference?
Not.
But how did you know the Japanese words?
Because he started to study the art in Europe, and he discovered Impressionist, and on the Impressionist painting, there was the back reproduced the Japanese print, and also they made some dress paint. It was really popular at the end of the 19th century, the Japan, and people make be crazy for Japan, and all people like the loves the printing, and the Bistro taught me that the Japanese printing came in Europe first time because of they used to cover with the commercial prints, all the cups of ceramics that they sent from Japan to Europe. And so, day after day, someone looks at these prints and love it and start to have interest. And with Impressionist, he discovered the Japanese, that they take a lot from Japan, and he was so interested in discover what Japanese art was. So he started to see where the museum was, and there was a museum in Genova, and he went to visit the museum each time he can, and with this he started to see directly from the prints. He see that was the gold, other things, and he decided to start and to try to do it, but it was really really hard. And I had at the library in Imperia, there is all the wood block card that I used for, because before to pass away, he make a gift to the city, and all is a property of the municipality of the area.
Yeah. And just another question, I'm sure other people got questions, but how did you know about paper, for example? Was he using paper from Italy, or was he...
No, he used only Japanese original washi paper, and he bought it from a shop specialized in art devices, and it was really interested in all Japanese tools and paper, and he made a lot of tests before to have the good effect that he want to have. Sorry for my English.
No.
Thank you so much for introducing this work.
Tomorrow morning, more focused on the techniques. And so if you want, I will be happy to meet you again at 11:30. And of course, all of you who like to come visit Italy and So thank you to whoever, everybody, for accepting my proposal to be here in this amazing location and at this inspiring conference to talk about my forthcoming publication. Now, the title has changed since I put the proposal in. It's called Perspectives on Contemporary Printmaking Critical Writing Since 1986. I'm the editor of it, and the book will be published by the renowned British publisher Manchester University Press in spring 2018. It includes 32 texts by various authors that were written in the period from the mid-1980s to the present. Now, I'm going to start with a confession. I think I did that the last time as well. During the almost 20 years during which I've been making and thinking and writing about prints, I did not read much about the subject until recently, namely the research for the book. And I don't seem to be alone in this. Other print artists have said the same to me. We read about art, but not necessarily about print, or not that much. Yet I've realized that my thinking about making prints and about printmaking as a field have been influenced not just by particular techniques and processes, crucial as they are, but all by the discourse of contemporary art. It has been informed by ideas that seem to circulate in the ether somehow. Ideas like surface, multiple, copy, matrix, and so on, just to name a few familiar examples. Hence, one rationale for putting the anthology together was to get a better handle on some of these seemingly free-floating ideas, to trace them to particular sources and contexts, to gain deeper insights, and to challenge myself and others. Nevertheless, one might wish to ask what purpose is there in a collection of texts on the meaning and status of print in printed form when we supposedly live in a post-print culture in which an immense number of sources is available at the click of a mouse. Moreover, what reason is there in dedicating a whole book to one, albeit greatly varied, discipline when art today is largely post-disciplinary, when the majority of artists adopts a variety of media and processes rather than following the modernist ethos of disciplinary purity? Now, for me personally, an early impetus for this anthology lay in the difficulty I encountered in finding Ruth Weisberg's frequently referenced essay of 1986, The Syntax of the Print in Search of an Aesthetic Context, which was published by the legendary Tamarind Papers, edited by the Tamarind Institute. Now, the availability of rapid, digitally delivered interlibrary loans today may have changed the situation. However, not everybody has access to an academic library. Also, not all texts are available at the click of a mouse. The writing on our subject has and is often published in geographically dispersed and not widely disseminated conference proceedings, biennale, or exhibition catalogs, journals, and specialist publications. So my intention with this project, therefore, is to provide a critical topography, a map of some of the debates on contemporary prints and printmaking over the last 30 years, albeit a necessarily partial map. So Perspectives on Contemporary Printmaking is the first anthology of its kind. It therefore presents a unique resource. Although it is inevitably shaped by the editors, i.e. my familiarity with the Anglo-Saxon context, it is not, unlike biennale and conference publications, bound by specific institutional or national agendas. Its framing of issues is based on a rigorous examination of the field. It's important to stress that Perspectives on Contemporary Printmaking does not deliver a general survey. This is for the simple reason that, as you will know, several such publications already exist in the English language. Additionally, countless publications are available in the form of catalogues of international print biennales and major exhibitions, for example, the landmark shows by the Museum of Modern Art in New York. And increasingly, conference proceedings such as IMPACT or indeed IMC. These tend to be focused on single and often topical, on a single and often topical premise or theme. The anthology, by contrast, uses a four-part thematic structure with further keywords in parts 3 and 4 to highlight issues and questions as to the history, ontology, discourse, and institutional material fields of printmaking practice over the course of the last 30 years. Now, why a special book when the subject has been and continues to be a solid, if marginal, branch of art history? In addition to general art historical journals, specialist journals such as Print Quarterly or Nouvelle de l'Estampe approach the subject from a largely art historical perspective. As of 2015, a scholarly forum for print specialists, some of you may know, the Association of Print Scholars, exists. This is a fantastic initiative for anyone specialized in matters of print, but currently, although APS welcomes both art historians and practitioners alike and is international in its remit, the majority of its active members appears to consist of North American curators and art historians rather than international print artists. That's my impression, I may be totally wrong. Debates on contemporary prints are not new either. Just consider the large body of writing by art historians and art critics on typically well-established contemporary artists who make prints. Artists themselves have spoken or written about their engagement with print for centuries. Just think of Picasso or Warhol. But Weisberg's essay of 1986 can be taken to mark an increasing self-consciousness and broadening of the discourse among artist printmakers themselves. This is not to deny the important role of earlier figures such as James McNeill Whistler or Stanley Hayter and many others for a self-understanding of modern printmaking as practiced in the West. However, Weisberg's essay can be taken as a prominent example of an extended critical engagement by a print artist with a broader philosophical and cultural framework of their own practice and discipline, rather than the attention to matters of style, motif, or technique alone. The roots for this heightened critical engagement lie in the often heated philosophical and cultural debates from the 1960s onwards. Echoes of this theoretical impact, for example, semiotics, can be found in the writing of authors such as Weisberg and others in the anthology. In recent years, the increasing emphasis on research in art, not just in the academic context, and the changing self-definition of artists, who are as much writers, speakers, curators, as well as the makers of their work, as many of you know too well, have furthered critical engagement with print from within the field itself. There are a number of examples of this development represented in the book. Now, during the period covered in the book, the number of print specialists, research-focused symposia at art institutions, but also at print workshops worldwide, has multiplied. So our conference is but one example. I think I got the slide slightly wrong. These are all biennales, but they often the biennales actually do have a symposia attached to them. But there have also been standalone symposia. There was one this summer in Cork, some of you in Cork in Ireland, for example. I went to one a couple of years ago. These were in Britain as well. And I have noticed that they really sort of mushroom. Now, by contrast, within the larger art context, recognition and critical appreciation of prints or printmaking still only occur marginally, if at all. As Canadian print artist Barbara Balfour has noted, when objects as diverse as the Shroud of Turin or Andy Warhol's paintings are not discussed expressly in terms of their printed qualities, I long for clarification to be made, not to claim their inclusion in some definitive list of printed works, but to acknowledge that part of what makes certain work interesting is connected to its printed nature. These situations make me want to call out, but it's a print. And I got this from the MoMA website. Yeah? Warhol likely based this painting on a film still. So, and I noticed I couldn't find my photograph of it a couple of years ago when I was in MoMA, that the actually the work in MoMA uses painting, the word painting, and print is not mentioned. It may mention acrylic something, but so this is quite this is maybe they've changed it since. I'm not quite sure. This was from the web, but because I couldn't find my photograph, but I certainly did notice it a couple of years ago. The marginal status of our subject is a phenomenon to which a number of texts in the anthology refer. It continues to exist despite the fact that prints have been and are a crucial feature of many contemporary artists' multimedia practice. Increasingly, however, printmaking's eccentricity, its outsider position, is regarded as a vantage point rather than a disadvantage. Susan Tormann, for example, has argued in this vein, as you can see here in her keynote speech, Wallflower at the Art World Ball for the second SNAP International Print Symposium in Germany in 2012. She said, the printmaker's print finds itself on the periphery, the Wallflower at the Art World Ball. Yet she also highlighted the advantages of such a position on the fringes. She said, because prints are out of the spotlight, the print offers a space that is more conducive to radical invention. The new hegemony of the digital in culture at large has simultaneously fueled interest in slow media and processes, of which the techniques of printmaking are one prominent example. This is mentioned by various authors in the book. The German art historian Ernst Rebel cites the reemergence of the woodcut as one example, and Moko Hanga can be said to benefit from the same phenomenon, and I'm sure you're aware of that. The crisis that was felt within the field of printmaking due to the appearance during the 1990s of digital technology, especially imaging software and home printers, led to initially often either absurdly enthusiastic or despairing reactions in equal measure. These, I think, have now been replaced by a cautiously optimistic mood as to the future of printmaking, partly for the reasons already mentioned, and also because digital technologies have been incorporated into or are complemented by, rather than having willy-nilly been replaced by, older technologies. And interestingly, if not surprisingly, print and its history is gaining attention in the context of the study of new media and new media art. The brief historical overviews by Beat Wiss and Ernst Rebel at the beginning of the anthology are both written from the perspective of a history of media. And there is a text by the French art historian Georges Didier Ubermann on the notion of the imprint that argues for a more complex understanding of history and temporality that permits us to look into the past to discover the present and future alike, and vice versa. Several factors give our subject prominence today over and above its specific manifestations, despite frequent proclamations of print's demise in culture at large. Amongst other things, I would count the increasing importance and wide practice of self-publishing in contemporary art. Contemporary art's emphasis on sociality, on collaboration, ethics, and political action have been vital features of print practice for centuries. The recognition of the importance of materiality, craft, and manual touch, as currently theorized, for example, in craft and art theory, has given new credence to a physically demanding discipline such as printmaking, and I think is especially interesting for Moko Hanga. The inherently mechanical nature of print makes its practitioners exceptionally well prepared to engage with and incorporate as well as contest new technologies. And the recognition that no medium is stable or fixed and should instead be regarded as multiple and heterogeneous has gained currency. The notion of an expanded print practice or print media as a collective term are indicators of this widening of the concept and practices of print that align it with contemporary multimedia art. These factors, even when not explicitly addressed in the individual texts within the book, are referenced in the extensive further reading list at the end of each of the four parts. Okay, now it's important to note what you will not find in the book. There are no technical discussions or texts dedicated to single print techniques, not even Mokuhanga, I'm sorry, I apologize. But the reason for this omission is twofold. There are countless publications, websites, blogs dedicated to the important subject of specific print techniques. And moreover, as several authors in the volume argue, printmaking has and is often primarily framed by writers and makers alike in terms of technology and techniques. And I wanted to avoid the same overemphasis, a collusion with the techno-fetish of printmakers, as it has been memorably called by the Australian Graham Cornwell in 1992 and critiqued more recently by Lewis Kumnitzer, the artist Lewis Kumnitzer. I do believe that the material aspects of a medium or media are vitally important. Indeed, as the Eva Laia Burchard and Isabel Groh have argued, the material and technical register of the work of art must be regarded as the very site rather than the mere support of meaning, as which it is often discussed. Hence, a number of the texts pay close attention to the making and of physical and technical makeup of prints. But I hope that the various contributions in the anthology show that technology and technique are never purely technical or mere tools, but that they are always mediated by multiple factors, economic, social, scientific, philosophical, cultural, aesthetic, and personal. No matter how immediate or pragmatically motivated they appear to an individual practitioner or indeed an institution. Also not included in the book are critical texts on individual artists by art historians or critics, although such work is often of a high quality and proposes broader insights into the field. Instead, I have aimed to include a variety of voices and authors with different professional identities and affiliations. There are contributions by art historians, curators, critics, but equally by artists themselves. And in addition to this authorial diversity, I have also opted for different textual formats or modes of writing, from longer, in-depth academic discussions to writing that combines theory and practice, as well as new modes of art writing that elide the theoretical and the poetic. This is to account for the fact that the conventional hierarchies between theory with a capital T and theory with a small t, between academic and creative, specialist and amateur knowledge, are being redrawn. Moreover, alternative modes of writing pay attention to their own texture and sensuous materiality, and hence correspond more closely to the art itself than conventional models of writing. Now, how am I doing for time?
You are just coming up to the end of about 20 minutes, so if you want 10 minutes of questions. So.
Well, I was going to go through the different parts, but if you rather, I can shorten that.
Should we just jump into some questions, or why don't you just finish that a little bit?
Okay, I'll shorten that. Okay. So the structure of the book, the texts are grouped into four themed sections, preceded by an introduction consisting of a brief outline of the text and their relevance. Part one, called Genealogy, provides a brief contextualization of Brent's broader history. Okay, so I'll leave that out and just jump to the next thing. The part two debates is chronologically organized, and this is to give an indication of the different emphasis of the debate on printmaking over the last 30 years. These texts are mostly written by artists themselves, act as markers for some of these debates, and give an indication of both continuities and differences in the conception, positioning, concerns, and practices of printmaking. And part three, key terms, pinpoints some of the significant concepts or nodes associated with prints and printmaking. Chief among them, reproduction, aura, the addition, the multiple, the matrix, the imprint. And as in botany, from such nodal points, further branches or directions emerge, and indeed often such key terms intersect, of course. Modes of production and examples of dissemination. Oops, I shouldn't do that. Anyway, never mind. I'll come to that point in a minute. It's circumscribes some of the major spheres of print activity under keywords such as production, collecting, dissemination, education, and research. Also included are items on geographical areas not covered elsewhere in the book, on basically China and Latin America. Each of the keywords in this section refers to and encompasses a wide range of activities that may complement, but at times also compete with each other. And I have made the point that that all of the parts, although they're separated out, contribute to the discourse of the field. So the separation into different parts of the division is simply for the purpose of easier analysis and should not be taken as definitive. Now, this slide I put in because inevitably this topography that the anthology provides is far from comprehensive and not intended as a conclusive recent history. As we are all aware, printmaking is now a truly global field with innumerable strands or force fields. Many of these are well connected. However, it's also important to bear in mind that others remain off the map. South African Dominic Thorburn's unpublished presentation at Impact 7 in 2011 made this point. It was titled Navigating the North-South Axis, Divide and Rule, and it examined some of the geopolitical imbalances that affect global print practices and exchanges. So therefore, the anthology should be approached in a spirit of orienteering, of promoting, oh, there it is, of promoting additional investigation and study, both practical and theoretical. And readers are encouraged to create their own map or tempo and thematic trajectory through the material presented in the volume and find the connections between different texts that are pertinent to them. By referring to further reading lists, readers are then able to create a diverse and interconnected web of multiple intersecting lines that lead beyond the book itself. I hope whoever looks at it will enjoy the ride. Mahalo nui loa.
I'm Paul Binney, for those who don't know me. Obviously, I'm a woodblock printmaker. I'm also an artist and painter, and do lots of other things too. So I'm mostly known, I think, now as a woodblock printmaker. So what I thought I'd do is just do a quick run through my 25 years as a printmaker. There's a timeline. So the timeline just basically goes through... I'm Scottish, I should start off by saying. I'm Scottish, and I was born in a town called Alloa, which kind of makes it appropriate that I'm somehow here with Alloa as my background. Anyway, Edinburgh University. I was a student there from 85 to 90, where I did my MA. I lived in Paris for a couple of years. I had a really strong interest in Japanese print, both at Edinburgh and living in Paris. And eventually, I sort of decided I should go to Tokyo and learn how to do woodblock printmaking. So from 1992 to 99, I was living in Japan. I studied off and on with various people. Ralph was a great help. I studied with Seki Kenji, who used to be the head printer at Doi Hangaten, which was one of Tokyo's print houses. They mostly publish prints by Koitsu and Hasui and so on. And that sort of links into the career that I ended up having because I was very interested in Shinhanga. That's the prints that were produced from about the period of the First World War right through to just after the Second World War, mostly the interwar period. And Shinhanga has been probably the biggest influence on my prints, as well as ukiyo-e, but Shinhanga much more so. I'll talk about this image that's on there in a moment, but I just put it up so you'd have something prettier to look at than me. I thought I would go through this and look at the different subject matters that interest me. This basically breaks down into four main areas, the first of which is tattoo. At Edinburgh, I was very interested in figure painting, figure drawing. I did a lot of portrait work. So the human figure is something that's really a major part of my work. And it seemed logical that using the figure and connecting with a traditional Japanese subject would bring tattoo into it. So tattoo has been a big thing for me. These two are part of an ongoing series, well, a series that just finished last year, which is called Edozumi Hyakushoku, which is 100 shades of ink of Edo. And in the series, what I've done is I've used various famous Edo period artists' work turned into tattoos and layered onto the bodies of the models that I've worked with. So the left-hand one is Kuniyoshi and his cats, and the right-hand one is Yoshitoshi and his ghosts. And the series eventually grew to be 10 different subjects. The left one here is Kunisada. Kunisada, and the actor is Danjuro, so the print is Kunisada and Danjuro. And the right-hand one is Hokusai, and he did a very famous series of waterfalls. So Hokusai's waterfalls are the subject for that one. In case you think they're all male, they're also females. So that within the 10, there are 5 male subjects and 5 female subjects. The left-hand one here is Hiroshige's Edo, so it's different views of Edo by Hiroshige. And the right-hand one is Utamaro's Shunga, so the erotic prints of Utamaro, and the tattoo on the girl's back is a Utamaro print. So within this series, I played a lot of little games. I mean, I'm very much a playful artist. I think I like humor in my work a lot. So things like the little seals are actually the letters of my name rearranged into the forms of something that refers to the subject. So for example, in the Hiroshige print, the seal is a carp, and it refers to one of the famous prints of Hiroshige's 100 Views of Edo, which is a koinobori, the carp banner that goes up on Boys' Day on the 5th of May. So the carp is rearranged into the letters of my name. Also at the top, the cartouche at the top with the title within the image reproduces the artist's signature. So it says Hiroshige, no. And then there's a little picture, and it's a picture of Edo from another print by Hiroshige. So there's layers of meaning in these prints, in this series particularly, where I'm referring to lots and lots of other things. But let's scamper on, because I don't want to be too long with this. My second subject was kabuki. And when I lived in Japan, I was working at the Kabukiza Theater as an earphone guide translator. And actually translate, because my Japanese were not that good. But if you go to the Kabuki Theater, and nowadays you get a little receiver and put it in your ear, you'll hear somebody talking to you about what's happening on the stage. So I was that person for a while in the 90s. It seems a long time ago now. This print is Ennosuke. Sadly, I noticed the other day that virtually all the actors that I worked with are now dead. Unfortunately, Enosuke is now dead. I did quite a few prints in this series, which is the Okubie series. So the first one was Enosuke. This is Jakuemon. And the other one is Danshiro, who was Enosuke's brother. That Dacha was still alive, but unfortunately the others are all dead. We'll move on from that. I did a second series in Japan as well on kabuki subjects called Heisei Yaksha Okanami series, which is a great mirror of the actors of the Heisei period. And this one is Bandō Tamasaburō, who is actually one of my favorite kabuki actors. He's an onnagata, so he plays female roles. And he's considered to be definitely one of the best of his period. When I was there, when I was in Japan, he was comparatively young. He's only a few years older than me, but that makes him quite old now, so we'll move on. The third subject that I was interested in, and I became more so in the later part of my stay in Japan, was landscape. I didn't really do an awful lot of landscape previously, but this one is an example from a series that was called the Shitamachi Setsugekka, so the snow, moon, and flowers of the Shitamachi, or the downtown part of Tokyo. And this one is the moon over Shinobazu. And Shinobazu is a pond. In fact, you can see the lotuses in the foreground of the pond that surround this little temple on an island, temple to Benten, on the island in Shinobazu Pond. And the others were the snow at Asakusa and the cherry blossoms at Ueno, which are very famous Saijo. Paul, you're waving at me.
about how many blocks for that one, Paul?
This is not that many. This is probably about, I can't honestly now remember. I have a feeling it was about 7 or 8 blocks, but printed with perhaps about 20-ish colors, something like that. I mean, as time goes on, there are more and more blocks and they get more complex. And some of the later, more recent ones are a lot more complex. But I was actually trying to keep it fairly simple. I mean, I know that sounds like quite a lot already, but I was keeping it quite simple at that time. Other Japanese landscapes. This is the Yomeimon at Nikko, so the main shrines to the Tokugawa shogunate. And this is the Chinese gate. And the right-hand side is the Yamadera, the mountain temple in Yamagata, up in northern Japan. And I was doing quite a sort of Hiroshige-type landscape again, with a very sort of high mountain temple and then a deep view to the valley below. But I think, again, these are quite a sort of Shinhanga-type design. Talking about Shinhanga, so Yoshita Hiroshi is an artist that I'm very, very interested in. This is his Grand Canyon view from 1925. His dates are 1876 to 1950, as you can see. One of the things that brought me into print was that I'm very interested as a collector in Shinhanga. So I collect Japanese prints as well. And Yoshita was somebody that I was very interested in collecting. About 10 years or so ago, I thought it might be fun to do a series where I was looking specifically at Yoshida and the things that he did in his own work. So this is my version of Grand Canyon. It's called Cloud Shadows Grand Canyon. And I titled the series Meisho to no Tabi, which means Travels with the Master. So I'm sort of stalking him 80 years later by going to the places that he went to in the 1920s or so, and following the things that he did, and doing my own versions of the views that he did at that time. So here's a comparison between Hiroshi Yoshida and myself. Different, but you know, they're not in such a very dramatically different aesthetic world, I think. If you see the physical prints, Hiroshi's print sort of, it's an Oban size print, it's that sort of size. Mine is quite a lot bigger. It's so big that I couldn't actually bring it with me to show you in person in the portfolio. But anyway, it's pretty big. I've done other things in the same series, the Meisho to no Tabi series. The left-hand one is Lugano in Switzerland. He did a horizontal view of Lugano, again in 1926. And 1924 again, he visited Niagara Falls, which is the right-hand side. My Lugano is an Oban size, but the Niagara Falls is just as big as the Grand Canyon. It's a very large print, and it was a lot of work. And Paul, to let you know, that's about 40-ish colors. I mean, it was just massive. It was a lot of work. The bokashi took forever. Anyway, so moving on. The last subject, the fourth subject that I deal with is Bijinga, pictures of beautiful women. And I came to this quite late. It was actually after I'd left Japan that I started to work in Bijinga. And in fact, this was the first design in Bijinga that I did because it was a commission. I was commissioned by someone to do a set called The Four Seasons. And this was the first design of The Four Seasons. It has Combing the Hair as a title, but it was produced as a print representing summer. She's wearing a light sort of cotton kimono rather than a yukata rather than a heavy silk kimono, and she's meant to be on a sort of sunny summer day. So Bijin have become something that has not maybe dominated my work, but it's certainly taken over to a large extent. So the sharp-eyed amongst you will notice that the left-hand one is the same as the woman with the tattoo that we saw earlier in the Edozumi Hyakushoku series. I quite often do variations on the same design. Once you've carved the blocks, then why not print them in different colorways? So this version on the left-hand side is called Engawa. The previous one was called Utamaru no Shunga. So it's exactly the same blocks, but without the tattoo, and the background printed in this sort of raspberry reddish color. And the right-hand side one is called Chomusubi, which is the bow, the butterfly-shaped bow on the back that the girl is wearing. Again, layers of reference. The kimono and the obi refer to a famous pair of screens by Ogata Korin that are held in the MoA Museum of the red and white plum blossoms with a river between. So it's a stylized version of the gold leaf and the river on her obi and then the plum blossoms and the, on her kimono. A series that I'm working on now currently is called Hyakunen no Hana. And this series is a little bit different because the title means flowers of 100 years. And what I've done is I've taken the 20th century, decade by decade, to look at how women's lives have advanced in the 20th century. Rather than doing, you know, yet more pictures of pretty girls combing their hair or putting on their makeup, I thought, let's look at how women are different in the 20th century, how their lives are getting better. The left-hand one is called Moga, which is a modern girl. So she's cut her hair, she's smoking, and she's drinking Manhattans with another person. So we can suggest that perhaps there's a male companion, and she's a bit free, she has her own money. She's somebody who has a bit of independence from the family home. The girl, and she represents 1920. And the girl on the right-hand side, it's called Protest March, and this represents 1960. And it's a protest against the government of the time and also against nuclear proliferation in Japan. Protests against nuclear weapons being kept in American naval bases in Japan. So within the series, I've looked at things like women's education, universal literacy, the rights of women to vote, and so on. I mean, it sounds quite boring, the academic, but I thought I wanted to break away from doing the sort of typical decorative views of women to do something that was a bit more about women's real situations. Occasionally I take commissions. I said that before I'd done the commission of the Four Seasons set, this print was another commission, Ho no Yume. So it means Phoenix Dream. It was commissioned by a gallery in Switzerland where I was doing a show, and in fact, and then fitted it to her more carefully. And you'll see that things like the kimono design have changed and so on. And the color scheme is very different to the previous one. So using the woodblocks to make color variants is something that's really quite important to my practice. A new series that I've been working on recently also is called Hongadori. And this is a play on words, because in Japanese poetry, Hongadori is a word that forms a bridge between two different ideas in Japanese poetry. So Hongadori is an image that forms a link from the past to my own work. And what I've done with this is I've taken original old woodblocks that I've found, usually with dealers or in antique shops and so on, and transformed them into a basis for my own print. So the left-hand one is called Casa Umbrellas, and the guy has a tattoo on his back, which is actually printed from an early 18th century woodblock. I found a keyblock for what I think was probably a fan print of the 18th century. It's quite a roundish design, and I thought that would fit quite nicely as a tattoo design on the back of this model. So the tattoo that he has is printed from an original 18th century block. And on the right-hand side, it's the background there, the print title is Hagoromo, which is, it means a feathered robe. It's also a title of a no play. But the tree with the robe hanging over it, again, comes from an 18th century woodblock, from the I think from the Torii school in that case. But I found this block and thought, how can I use this to make a print? So I turned it into a screen design behind the girl. You can't see it very well here, but when you see the portfolio presentation, I've got this print with me, and the pale turquoise robe is deeply embossed with feathered design as well. So again, she's wearing a feathered robe. There's a feathered robe over the tree behind, and it sort of brings in connection between these two things. Again, I like playing games. Jigoku Dayu is the hell courtesan. And in traditional versions of this story, she encounters a famous priest, and from that, the priest understands that she has more of a meaning, more of a perception of heaven and hell than he does himself. In my version of it, she has a robe that's covered in the figures in hell itself. You've got Emma, the king of hell, down at the bottom left, and then various demons torturing the souls of the people condemned to hell on her robe. She's also got a hand that's wizened away to a sort of skeleton, so it's just a slightly humorous kind of image. The right-hand one is, excuse me, is a commission that was given by Amherst College in Massachusetts. They had a single sheet 18th century print by Shuncho, and they wanted artists to make a collaboration in a way with an old print. So I chose a Shuncho print, and instead of doing a completely Japanese image, I decided to import somebody in a sort of an impossible invented history, import an 18th century lady into a Japanese situation. But of course, Japan was closed to the outside world at this time. Nobody knew what people were wearing in France in the 18th century. But this is a French 18th century costume transported into a sort of 18th century Japanese garden, playing games. So just in case you think everything is kind of Shinhanga-ish, my last image, this is a very new print, and I just did it a couple of months ago. These cranes are of the very latest design, I just discovered. They're the newest cranes that are in use in Tokyo, and although I've put it against quite a pretty background, it's a very simple and much more sort of creative print, Sosaku print style than the Shinhanga stuff I normally do. So that's just to show that there is a bit more. Good. Okay, I think that's about it. Does anyone have any questions?
What kind of woods are you using?
So the key blocks are cherry wood on a Shina core. And most of the color blocks are Shina, unless there's lots of detail, in which case I might use the same, like cherry and Shina. But I find that Shina is good for large areas, flat areas of color, because the grain doesn't come through so much. And I try to avoid using grain, except for specific reasons. I mean, if I'm using an area where I want grain, then I'll use it. But I tend to want to print flat.
You get your wood from Japan?
Yes, it all comes from Japan. Okay. It's from Matsumura, actually. We were talking about that. We were talking about the job before.
Paul, I wanted to ask you, what is the brand of your pigment? Is it paste or like a powder?
So I use a mix of different things. I use some Nihonga pigments, and so Nihonga is Japanese water-based painting, for those who don't know it, and it's very useful because it's quite opaque. A lot of it's mixed with gofen, which is the white Chinese white shell powder. I also use powder pigment, normal Western powder pigment. I sometimes use gouache, which is already made up in tubes. I sometimes use watercolor. It just really depends. I mean, I'm not strictly sticking to only one kind of pigment, so it's a mix of different things, really. But the blacks and grays are usually sumi, because sumi is nice and permanent. Can I come back to you in one second, Ruth? You've been asking.
Yes, I wondered, can you say a little bit more about why Shinhanga?
Because
what
I love
about,
it.
What about
I think, okay, so I came to Shinhanga mostly because, as a collector, it was the thing that really appealed to me. And because I think when you're handling things on a daily basis, when you're buying things, you're looking at them all the time, you can't help but have that as an influence in your work. And it was definitely the thing that drew me, because I was interested in collecting those things, and therefore that became the thing that I was looking at most. And then therefore that had a knock-on effect into what was influencing my work. And I sort of fell in love with Shinhanga because there is a mix of very, very fine technique and traditional Japanese aesthetic melded to a slightly Western view as well. And I think somebody like Yoshida Hiroshi, he starts off being Japanese by birth, but he is trained as a Western artist. He trains as an oil painter and a watercolorist, and then goes into print. And in the same way, so I was born in the West, trained as a Western painter, and then went into Japanese print. So we're sort of meeting somewhere in the middle. And I thought that connection was quite interesting. So he specifically became somebody I was very, very interested in. And then also people like Hasui and Shinsui and Kotondo and all the other artists of the same period. Sorry, did you ask?
I was just wondering about your studio. So how do you work? Do you sit on the floor?
Yep.
Straight answer. But anyway, you have studied in Japan also, so you have to, if you have to sit on the floor and use the...
Yeah, I used to sit on the floor to print, and I think you came to my place in Sendagai, and I was always sitting on the floor printing away and doing all that. Mm-hmm. I used to do that, but I moved to London in 1999, and for a very short time I tried sitting on the floor, but it's so painful in my legs. I can't do it for very long. So I sit on a chair and I print at a table.
Okay. And how do you control the humidity? Because in Finland there's really, really dry air during the winter.
Oh, you should
so
come to London. It's not that dry. It's really not that dry.
Oh, yes,
rains
yes.
All the time in England.
Okay.
There have been times when it does get quite dry. Like in winter in England, it can be quite dry. So in the morning, I tend to just mist around with a mister. And if I find that the air is getting a bit dry, well, because I also keep houseplants as well, so that helps keep a bit of moisture in the air too. I never find humidity a particular problem because the paper has to be damp, but I don't have to be damp. That's not such a big deal for me. So, but you know, I'm very different to John. I don't keep my paper dry day after day, damp day after day. So at the end of my printing day, I dry everything.
Really?
Yeah, and then the next day I'll damp it in the morning and then print it and then dry it. Yeah. So I was talking with John about this, that when I'm doing my standard edition size is about 100, and I split it into two halves and print the first half one day, the second half the next day. So while the first day is drying, I'm printing the second day. And then when the second day is drying, I'm printing the first day again. So, you know, you alternate day by day. It's just much easier. So the humidity, I've never really found that to be a problem. I don't use central heating during the winter, because that does tend to dry things
yes.
out. Like if you're working on a wood block and with central heating, it's impossible. It dries out really fast. So I tend to freeze in the winter time. sit under a blanket when I'm doing it.
That sounds very
I would say that's probably it. Put up with it.
And all your edition, that seems do it all at once, you don't produce half of it, and then...
I used to do this, do you know, I used to, in some of the early things, particularly the kabuki prints and so on, I produced 30 or 40 at first. Uh-huh. And then I would be caught out, because I'd suddenly go, oh God, there's none of these left, and people want them, and I've got a show, and so nowadays I don't do that, I just print the whole lot at once. So it means I've got a big, I mean, basically it's an architect's drawing chest, on top of an architect's drawing chest, and it's full of prints. Just because I now produce a whole edition at once. But Plus then you get a sort of regularity, like everything from number 1 to number 100 is the same, more or less. You know, so there's slight variation. Yeah, John.
Yeah, could you speak about the last, you've been doing this for 30
years? 25, come on, 30.
All right, But this Western interest in this, I mean, what are some of your observations about how that's kind of opened up in the West? I mean, I think there's a perception in Japan that some of what we do is a little old-fashioned.
But it's definitely old-fashioned.
Yeah, yeah.
But you buy into that, that's
for
okay.
The West, it's so delightfully exotic sometimes, too.
Yeah.
So I was just kind of curious about the last 25 years.
Things have definitely changed, I think. Not always for the better, because I think, honestly, when I started in the early 90s, it was just at the end of the bubble period in Japan, and people were rich, and Japanese buyers were buying woodblock prints from all over the world, and so on. But then, you know, the bubble burst, and the Japanese economy has not been great for the last, well, nearly 25 years. So the Japanese buyer market is not there. The Western interest in prints is kind of flowing on and maybe getting a little bit stronger, but it's not, you know, it's not an overwhelming interest. It's a small minority interest, and there's nothing wrong with that. I think that's okay. I would say, I think there are some individual collectors and museums who are keeping sort of collecting art. I think we'll talk more about this in our
this
talk.
This evening from
yeah.
7 to 9,
we'll talk
be
about that.
On a panel, and Tula and Ruth, so there'll be lots to talk about then.
Yeah.
So maybe we'll talk more about that at that
about
point,
masks.
But yeah, that definitely does exist. Yeah?
Just a curiosity, is Borussia today among your
God, if I had a dollar for the times that people mention Paul Jacquelet. No, he is not. I think Paul Jacquelet was very lucky because he had enough money that he could employ carvers and printers, and he can use very lovely techniques like we were talking about, pearl and gold leaf and all of this. I'm not a massive fan of Paul Jacquelet. I think his drawing was sometimes a bit not so good, I'm sorry to say. but for the idea of a foreigner working in Japan, I mean, there were quite a lot of others in the 20s and 30s who were doing it. Elizabeth Keith, Charles Bartlett, there's so many, there's about half a dozen people who were also doing that, but Jacquelet is the one that people tend to know. So I would say I'm interested in Keith and Bartlett, I'm not so interested in Jacquelet.
Maybe we'll stop there, and if you want to ask Paul or Ruth any more questions, I think lunch is downstairs.
Lunch is downstairs for anybody that has red tag under your name. Lunch is provided.